Hello, lovely Functus. I hope you are all doing great. We are back to our virtual learning. And without wasting my time, let's move straight to the business for the day. We continue with our topic, our constitution. And today happens to be lesson 3 of the same topic, our constitution. Let's move straight to what we have to learn for today. We are going to explain the concept of separation of powers. The concept of separation of powers. Now, let me explain the concept of separation of powers. The concept of separation of powers means that the three main arms of government, we have the executive, judiciary, and the legislature, are to work independently. Okay? Executive, judiciary, and the legislature have to work independently so that no one arm of government becomes what? Powerful than the other arm of government. So what it means is that the Constitution says that the function of the executive must be performed by the executive. The function of the legislature must be performed by only the legislature. And the function of the judiciary must also be performed by only the what? The judiciary. So you see that the Constitution has spelled out the functions of the three main arms of government. That makes them all independent on their own. Okay? Now, that is it. It also has what advantages and disadvantages. Separation of powers has advantages and disadvantages. Now, we start with the advantages of separation of powers. He said it helps to prevent dictatorship. What does it mean? What it means is that one arm of government is not allowed to dictate for the other arm of government, because we are all supposed to be independent, or our functions have been spelled out in the Constitution. Okay? So the judiciary are meant to interpret the Constitution. Executive formulate and implement policies, and the legislature is to make what? Laws. So one arm of government cannot dictate for the other arm of government. So separation of powers is there to what? Prevent what? Dictatorship. You cannot behave or presume to be powerful than another arm of government, which is not possible. Now, it also says it leads to fairness in national administration. Since the executive is performing its powers, judiciary performing its powers, and the legislature also performing its powers, there's fairness in the administration of the country. Let's continue. It says that it creates efficiency and specialization. The judiciary is always interpreting the law and the Constitution of Ghana. So our judges are specialized in interpretation of what? Laws. The judiciary are also, the executive are always formulating and implement policies. So they become special in that field. They're able to formulate and implement policy. That is their main job. So they become specialized in that area. I mean, they become experts. Now the legislature or parliament also make laws. They make and amend laws. So as you keep on making laws and amending laws, you can specialize in making and amending of what? Laws. That's what it means by saying efficiency and what? Specialization. Now another one is that it protects the rights or liberties of Ghanaians. Your liberty or your right is protected as a Ghanaian, because you know that anytime your right is abused, you know where to go. Straight to the what? The judiciary, which is a court. If you want a law to be made in this country, you know where to go. That is the legislature. Okay? Now, it also says that it limits the powers of the arms of government. What it means is that it prevents one arm of government become what? More powerful than the other arm of government. So we are all on the same scale. The three arms of government must all be on the same scale. No one arm of government must be powerful than the other arm of government. Let's continue. We don't waste too much time. We move to the disadvantages of separation of powers. It says that one, it is not practical except with the concept of what? Checks and balances. It is just theoretical, just on paper. It's just on paper. But in practical terms, it doesn't work unless it comes with the concept of what? Checks and balances. The checks and balances is when one arm of government is allowed to check the other arm of government so that it doesn't abuse its power or its powers. Okay? So it is not practical, means that we need another concept to make it what? Practical. and can only become practical, sacrificial prayer can only become practical when there's a constant what? Checks and balances. Now, you say it delays government work. How does it delay government work? Now, the judiciary are supposed to what? Interpret the constitution or interpret our laws. But which arm of government is making the laws? It is the what? The legislature or parliament. They are making the law for the judiciary to interpret. So you see that there's going to be delay of government work or functions. Now, another way by which it also delays government work is that a typical example is that the executive prepares what you call the national budget and they need approval of the parliament or legislature. So you see that it delays government work. The third one is that it never gives total independence. It never gives total independence. So the concept is saying that all the three arms of government must work independently of each other. But in reality, it is not true. How? Executive nominates ministers and they are vetted and approved by parliament. So what makes, how does the executive become independent? You nominate a minister, the minister is vetted and what? Approved by parliament. So in context, you are not totally independent. So another one says that it increases the size and expenditure of government. Why can't the executive prepare their budget for the year and approve it or start with expenditure? But rather, they have to prepare the budget, send the budget to the executive. All this involves cost to the state. So the government spend more money in administration of the world, the states. Now we'll move to the concept of checks and balances. The concept of checks and balances say that the three arms of government, though, must work independently, but each arm of government has the power to check the other arm of government so that they do not abuse their powers. The concept say that, checks and balances say that the three arms of government, each arm of government must check the other so that they do not abuse their powers. As if checks and balances doesn't come in, as you are saying, separation of powers will not work. And it is there because it wants the three arms of government not to abuse their powers. Now, let's go to the checks and balances under the 1992 Constitution of Ghana. How are the various arms of government checking each other? How are the various arms of government checking each other? Now, one example as I gave earlier on was that the judiciary are supposed to interpret the law. But the laws are supposed to interpret, the laws are made by the legislature. So in a way, the legislature is checking the judiciary. Anytime the executive wants to spend money, they need approval of parliament. So in a way, parliament is also checking the executive. The salary of the parliamentarians are determined by the executive. So in a way, the executive is also checking the legislature. So you see that they all work hand in hand. It's like strike my back, government system, right behalf. So the three arms of government are checking each other. Now let's move to the importance of checks and balances. How is checks and balances important? One, it prevents dictatorship, as I said. It is there to make sure that no one arm of government becomes more powerful than the other. Two, it ensures good and proper decision making in governance. Because before a decision will be taken, it goes through a lot of processes. Okay? Before the government take a decision, the executive must send the decision they want to take. If they want to make a law, it must go through the legislature or parliament. They have to scrutinize the whole thing before they even approve it. So you see that it helps in decision making and we end up taking what? Good decision, because no one of the government sits somewhere and take decision. All decision taken go through what? A process. Now, it also ensures balance of power. It ensures balance of power. How? Because the executive is always checking the legislature. The legislature is also always checking what? The executive. The same thing, the executive in a way is checking the judiciary. The judiciary is also in a way checking the word executive. So there's balance of power here. Now, let's move to the disadvantages of checks and balances.
disadvantages.
What?
Checks and balance. One, unnecessary interference among the arms of government. Checks and balances just promote unnecessary interference among the arms of government. One arm of government will unnecessarily check the other, which is not necessary. I mean, it's not necessary. Okay? Two, it can slow down decision making in governance. As I was saying, that if there should be a decision to be taken, one arm of government must start the process, move it to another arm of government for it to go through before the final decision will be taken. So it delays. The last one is, it can lead to conflict. It can lead to what? Conflict. A typical example, we are saying that the legislature is supposed to make law. But you see that the judiciary, in a way, also make law, which is called case law. Okay? The judiciary, in a way, is also making a law, which is called case law. So you can see that there's conflict of power here. Okay? One arm of government is trying to perform the function of the another arm of government. Okay? So in a way, it is helping or in a way leading to a conflict among the various arm of government. I hope you have enjoyed the lesson. We come to the end of today's lesson. Waiting to see you in another lesson. Bye-bye.